and welcome. You're watching Head to Head. I'm Antonina Antosha with UATV. The wave of populism and nationalism across Europe, of which Brexit is a major expression, has transformed the political landscape. And it has also changed the way the political players interact with each other. Right-wing and nationalist parties have gained a sizeable number of seats in the European Parliament following the European elections in May. So what is the real influence of populists now in Europe, and what does the rise of populist parties mean for Ukraine in geopolitical terms? To discuss this and more, we welcome to our studio today Dr. Sybe Schaap. He's a philosopher and a Dutch politician. Hello and thank you for joining us.
Yeah, great to be here.
So, you have published 9 books overall, and the latest book is called The Populist Temptation. It's going to be published only next week, but I do have it here. I would like to show it to the audience.
It's already published, yeah.
And it's based on the problems of a totalitarian society in terms of Marxism and philosophy of Friedrich Nietzsche. Could you dwell a little bit more on your latest work?
Yeah. Well, it is a number such and so much, you know. My overall question is, you know, what's going on in the world now? Mm-hmm. And that is more than what we
so
see.
So what's going on in the world?
And what, you know, is at the bottom. And okay. We live in a time that the traditional values that we always esteem so very highly, they are disappearing. Like human truthfulness, you know, that we love truth, or moral integrity, that mm-hmm. we are open in speaking about good and evil and so on. And what you see now, you know, that those values lose their importance, lose their attraction. And now we see a wave going, especially through politics, but you can find it everywhere in society, well, which we call populism. And it is not only, you know, that they confess themselves to nationalism, or, you know, to the triumph of the nation, mm-hmm. but it has also a lot to do with a different attitude.
How does populism... such a movement, let's say, as populism, change the basis of the human values?
Yeah. Well, it's not coming from scratch, of course, you know. It has to do with the developments in the recent history. Mm-hmm. It's why I have read Nietzsche very intensively, and I am using that philosopher. Mm-hmm. 1.5 century ago, he already told, you know, that this will happen, that those values I spoke about, that they lose their attractiveness. Mm-hmm. And so populism is only, as I say it, a symptom of
what
is more of
right?
it. Of course, they are catalyzing it as well, you know, and radicalizing it, but you should make it broader than only what you see in politics now.
Well, if the traditional values, as you have just said, are going to lose their attractiveness, what's going to come in their place?
Yeah. You know, when we speak about truth, then you are open to make a difference between what's true, so what is factual, mm-hmm. and what has to be studied, you know, and mm-hmm. has to be approached in an honest way, a difference between what is true and what is a lie or what is fiction. And now you see that the difference between truth and lies is disappearing. And look to examples, you know, that are ahead now, like Boris Johnson in the United Kingdom or Donald Trump in the United States. They openly speak with lies. They know it is lies. And they do it in a shameless way because they are not interested, you know, whether it's true or a lie.
They are not the only ones speaking lies from the tribunes. Let's talk about Vladimir Putin here, right?
Well, that is another one. But, you know, the most the noise nowadays comes from Britain and the United States. Mm-hmm. And they are so open in expressing lies, but it's shameless, and that is new. Mm-hmm. You know, as a child, you always are open to tell lies, but then your parents, you know, tell you, hey, what did you say? And then you feel ashamed a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
And you have to learn that, you know, to feel ashamed. Now, it's gone. It's gone.
So
people.
The shame
and this,
is gone.
And this is, yeah, the same. The shame is gone, and that is very, very dangerous. Because when you remember them, you know, that it's not true what they say, it makes no impression on them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I have some numbers here provided by The Guardian that say that when populism was a blip on the horizon of European politics, that was at the beginning of the century. Since then, the number of Europeans voting for populist parties in national votes has risen from 7% to more than 25%.
Yes.
To what do we owe such a change.
Yeah, and this is not the worst thing, because when those parties are openly mm-hmm. populist, you can see them, mm-hmm. you can notice what they are doing. Why I gave my book the title The Populist Temptation, then I want to express, you know, that what they are doing and telling, so also the nationalism, you know, all that stuff, that it is infiltrating in other political parties as well, mm-hmm. and that it is infiltrating in human mind in general as well. So the populism you see is one thing, but the populism that already poisons and infiltrates everywhere, that is another thing. And that is more dangerous because you don't see it right away.
Because you don't realize that it's being put in your head, right?
Yeah, so it's a new normality. Mm-hmm. And that makes it so dangerous.
In your opinion, would it be fair to say that the Europe has reached its peak of populism by this time?
The voters could be, but I don't know. I can tell a little bit more why I am in the end. I'm still optimistic, but the number of voters could have peaked, like you have seen in Austria mm-hmm. and probably in mm-hmm. Italy and in France, you know, when Macron came in. So the number of voters, well, that is one thing. But look to the Conservative Party in mm-hmm. the United Kingdom. Suddenly, you know, it was not a Conservative Party anymore in the tradition of Edmund Burke,
right.
but suddenly it was a populist party in the tradition of Rousseau and other guys, you know, that are at the roots of this man.
And the change was pretty sudden.
But before it changed, you know, it worked already.
Yeah.
So new people came in, new leaders came in, and the old leaders, they gave up.
The basis was being laid up.
And that makes it so dangerous, you know. The Republican Party, the same. It was a conservative party. But how is it possible that Trump could infiltrate in that party? Because it already collapsed as a conservative party mm-hmm. and turned into a populist one.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so it can happen also unexpectedly.
What can you say about the level of populism in Ukraine right now?
I am, you know, I have been here for 30 years, so I know the country a little bit, but it is more from a practical approach, like working in agriculture here and in water management.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, you come to understand the country a little bit. I don't think that populism now is a real huge problem.
In Ukraine?
No, I don't think, not like in Austria or in the Netherlands.
What about if you compare it to the level of populism in Europe?
Yeah, well, you can see, you know, what's happening now in Hungary.
Okay.
And what was threatening to happen in Italy. And what happened already in Greece. So it's very powerful understream as well as an open stream in politics.
Mm-hmm.
But may I add one thing to it?
Sure.
We had populism before. The Nazis was also a populist movement. Communism.
Before democracy?
Well, they used democracy, you know. It's not against democracy.
Okay.
The communism started as an internationalist movement, but in short time it was a nationalist movement under Stalin already as well.
Mm-hmm.
Fascism mm-hmm. is populist. All these movements had a good sense of future. They destroyed a lot, but they worked for something that could come, like a utopian society, a utopian life, you know, or a racist, mm-hmm. pure life, or what more. They had an idea of future where to work for. This new populism has no idea of future at all. It's even worse, for them, future is a black hole. They are pessimistic, they fear catastrophes, etc. So they only speak about the past, what has been, and not about future. And even the past is destroyed by them, because it's just a story about the past, you know, the golden uh-huh. age we were in, and that has to be restored, but that golden age never existed. But they have no idea of future. And so I, once in a time, come to the statement...
Is that an official warning?
Yeah, I many times I say, listen, this type of populism has no future. They don't have it, and probably, you know, it will collapse, because they don't know where to work for.
Okay, taking into account what you've just said, especially the sentence when you said that the populism as it is right now doesn't have any future, what can we await in the future for Europe and the whole international geopolitical arena, considering that the right-wing parties are taking over in the majority of the countries of the European Union?
then this would be right-wing parties. But okay, that is another discussion. Some of them say they are right-wing, but are left-wing.
Okay.
but that doesn't matter.
Okay.
The biggest danger is not that they take over power, but that they have a lot of destructive effects. A nice example of that is Venezuela. You know, that was a left-wing populist, Chavez, who came in. He destroyed his country completely, and still he was popular. And look what a ruinous situation you have now. The same could happen in the United Kingdom. It already, the country is broken apart, you know, the two wings, you know, the Brexiteers and the others. But also the country as it is composed, like together with Scotland and Northern Ireland and so, it's collapsing as well. So the effect of populism is very, very destructive.
And then I
hope, I hope that enough people see that this populism has nothing to offer, only destruction.
Then why is the idea of populism resonating so on such a high pitch in economically prosperous countries like the Netherlands?
This is the good question. You couldn't believe, you know, then like my country, it is so prosperous. Do we have problems? Of course, small ones, very small. And we can discuss. We have the money, you know, to repair things. And still, human beings are so unsatisfied and give the impression not feeling home and also scared for the future. Once and again, people say, oh, my children, you know, they don't have such a good life as we have, you know. So they are pessimistic and cynical. Where does that come from? Well, that is a philosophical question. I wrote already a new book in the Netherlands. It will be published in November. And then I go deeply into that question. Where does that come from?
All right, then we're looking forward to your new book.
Yeah.
I know that you've participated in the preparation process for the referendum in the Netherlands concerning the question of Ukraine and the agreement association with the European Union. The turnout was critically low. And even though, nevertheless, the majority of the of your compatriots that came to the voting stations were against the idea.
Yeah.
Why do you think is that?
All the discussions we had around that referendum on Ukraine had nothing to do with Ukraine. I think nobody in the Netherlands had any idea, you know, of what was written in the treaty.
Okay, then what's the result then?
So that was a vote against Europe. It was a vote against the government. It was a vote against God knows what. And so they expressed a negative attitude, you know, and that's it. And that had to be translated into, well, as you have seen, you know, some additions to the treaty in order to get it through the parliament.
Well, there has been a point of view expressed that the anti-Ukrainian mood and the anti-Ukrainian campaign currently run in the Netherlands has been sponsored by the Kremlin or by the inner circle of the Russia's president, Vladimir Putin. Do you agree?
The two populist parties we have are very, very friendly on Putin, and I don't know whether they are paid or not. You know that, but they were against Ukraine because they were in favor of Putin. And one of the two, both of them, they visited Russia, visited probably Putin. I don't know, and so the referendum on the Ukraine treaty was taken over by the two populist parties and transformed into a vote against Europe and somehow pro-Russia, pro-Putin anyway. Because he is a role model for them, you know, Putin, a role model. So they see the leader. And Putin, you know, how he speaks about Russia and the Russian soul and so on. That is something they like, you know. They want to have a Netherlands soul, you know, and they are expressing it.
Okay, so what's the future between Ukraine and the Netherlands then?
I hope very intensive. You know, I did, when I was a member of the Senate, I did foreign affairs, Europe and foreign affairs. And I did a lot of work to get the treaty accepted in the Senate. Mm-hmm. In the House of Representatives, there was a government majority, that was no problem. But in the Senate, there was no majority. Mm-hmm. So I had to convince a few parties, you know, to change their ideas. Well, it happened. Well, I don't say that I saved the treaty, but anyway, mm-hmm. I did my efforts to do it. And I really believe in a lot of cooperation between the Netherlands and Ukraine. For instance, in agriculture.
Yes.
You are.
But
this is not the only
sphere that Ukraine could, you know, provide in agriculture.
You know, the Netherlands is a superpower in agriculture. Everybody knows, the second exporter worldwide, even being such a small country. But mm-hmm. we have a lot to offer in technology, in seeds,
auto machinery,
and so on, machinery, everything. You have room. You have high qualified land. You have, of course, all the possibilities, you know, to develop agriculture. And when we could join a little bit more, you can, well, expect, you know, what might happen.
Okay.
And that is only one branch. There is much more in which we can cooperate. But mm-hmm. that is the thing, you know, I am familiar with.
Okay, hopefully in the future then.
Do it.
And for the last question, could you give a little forecast? What's going to happen to Europe, let's say, within the next 2 years? 10 years, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm not a prophet.
Well, how's it going to look, geopolitically?
There has been a lot of skepticism against the European Union as mm-hmm. a treaty community. And that skepticism is going down now a little bit. And that makes me optimistic. And of course, the Brexiteers, they set an example, you know, what might happen when you leave.
That is a quite bright example a member of the EU should not be doing.
And Ukraine, you know, has to get as closely as possible towards Europe. And that is my warning to the country. You have your treaty, but please take it seriously, you know, mm-hmm. and fulfill all the terms, you know, that were described in that treaty. And, a membership, that is something for future, you know. But mm-hmm. to cooperate more and more and more, that asks a lot of reform in this country.
And this is the responsibility of our new appointed government, and we're all there looking very much forward for the new government to deliver the promises that were being made before.
And now, after the elections, you know, that new generation came in. Mm-hmm. And, I hope, you know, that they are open for this types of reforms.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming. It was a very interesting conversation.
Oh, great to speak with you.
Thank you. That was Dr. Sybe Schaap. He's a philosopher and a Dutch politician. Thank you so much for watching UATV. Stay tuned for more.